Adaptions surround us. Not exactly what I meant. They exist in many forms. Real life into books, books into plays, plays into movies, movies into television shows into books, and round we go.
You are Clark Kent, right?
While books into movies is typically seen as the highest form of adaptation, winning over 50% of the Academy Awards in the Best Adapted Screenplay category.
Adam McKay, The Big Short.
All the President's Men by William Golden.
Lawrence Houben and Beau Golden for One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Ernest Tidyman for The French Connection.
Winner is Mario Puzo and Francis Ford Coppola for The Godfather.
Adaptations of books constantly face arguments about authenticity, and this is the same for comic books. To quote Andre Bazin, the high priest of realism, who practically invented film studies, he summarizes adaptations as aesthetically justified, independent of their pedagogical and social value, because the adapted work, to a certain extent, exists apart from what is wrongly called its style, which is a confusion of this term with the word form. What he means by form is that people confuse style when they really mean form, and form in this case is the novel versus the movie. He expresses that in the future, literary critics won't look at the individual forms a story was told, a la a play, a book, a radio, a drama, a movie, etc., but critics will see the story as it is, living in multiple forms that express different aesthetics. This would be equivalent to like how a Shakespeare play can be adapted to a movie, but it's still the same meaning behind it, it's just in a different form. I want to talk about comic book adaptations. Unlike books, which are full of words, leaving the images to be imagined by the reader, comic books are full of images, and the juxtaposition and arrangement of these images is what can hurt a particular comic book or elevate it to stardom. With this visual element being crucial to the medium, how does one analyze comic book movie adaptations? Do you judge Superman by Richard Donner as a great piece of art because it made you feel good? Or do you look at Man of Steel by Zack Snyder as bad because it was too dark, gloomy, and real? The condensing of multiple issues and stories is the most common form of comic book adaptation. The Marvel Cinematic Universe, or MCU, tends to take a run or series of issues and condense them into one movie. So retelling or reimagining is also done in order to tell a more coherent and family-friendly story. For example, Robert Downey Jr., who plays billionaire tech giant Tony Stark, aka, has appeared in 10 of the last 22 MCU films. And the one huge character flaw fans have missed is Tony's fight with alcoholism.
Peace.
As Dudley Andrew would say, the MCU has done mostly borrowing of their original work and pushed it into a streamlined, cohesive narrative that never sways away from the PG-13 rating. And now that Disney owns Marvel, the Disney way is likely to be the future of the MCU brand. As it pertains to visuals, many comic book adaptations don't reflect the visuals of the comic book, with exceptions to costumes and general aesthetics. Conrad Hall, for example, who won the Director of Photography Oscar for The Road to Perdition, that film was in color, but while the comic book was in black and white. It could be argued that the film's looks reflected the visual aesthetic of the original comic book, which was of a film noir style. Also, many non-superhero comics tend to be in black and white since they are cheaper to produce. Also, black and white comics tend to help separate it from the glossy, saturated superhero worlds that characters like Superman and Iron Man inhabit. Because of this, looking at the whole, a lot of comic books are black and white. Japanese comic books, also known as mangas, are also all in black and white, even though their anime counterpart are always in color. Some comic books will be in black and white with one element or character being in color. For example, the comic book Blue is the Warmest Color was black and white with the exception of the color blue, which was usually represented by the one character's blue hair. The movie, though, was all in color, and in some ways, it could be argued that the strange, queer-esque blue hair was less impactful, while the remainder of the film was also in color. So far, the titles I've mentioned are clear adaptations, while Bartosz and Stolman, I don't know how to pronounce these people's names, propose translation as a better term for comics to film pieces. A translation could apply the means of the new medium to create a cinematic form determined by the original and its aesthetic properties. Released in 2005, Sin City was predominantly in black and white, with a singular color or two represented. But unlike other black and white comics, Sin City had a much harsher contrast to emulate the noir style. Robert Rodriguez, in his film translation, had Frank Miller credited as co-director, as Miller's panels were used as storyboards. Not only was the story translated, but the visual look of the comic was too. Some believing it's the best comic book adaptation or translation because of its visual imitation, or as Rodriguez called it himself, translation. He said instead of adapting the comic to cinema, we can turn it around and bring the comic to life and really just translate it to the screen. The film was shot entirely on a green screen set in order to create, in post-production, the look of the deep, contrasting landscape the graphic novel created. Only certain colors and certain moments come alive to break up the bleakness the black and white creates. For example, blood, not always, but when necessary, appears red, or the character, the Yellow Bastard, actually appearing yellow. With this film, Rodriguez undoubtedly set the bar on comic book adaptations, but still, when watching the film, it's apparent that it's a comic book film and nothing more. In 2007, Zack Snyder released his film adaptation of Frank Miller's 300, where Rodriguez copied just the look, Snyder copied the look and motion of the panels. Snyder used high frame rates in order to manipulate the motion of the image.
Super slow motion.
Come on, I might as well be reading the book.
This is another aspect inherent to a comic to film translation, the transformation and rearrangement of static panels into moving images, resulting of manipulating the speed of movement by slowing it down to an almost static image. Snyder replicates the look of the original comic book panel, capturing motion in a motionless image. Then the speed ramps back up and the action resumes. The effect not only emulates the comic book's original artwork, but also emulates the experience people have when in high stress, fearful moments, and the illusion that time is slowing down. The film 300 stayed closer to the story of the graphic novel than any other adaptation, but it should be noted that Frank Miller's story is also highly inaccurate to the actual historical events and to some of the actual Spartan culture. As Miller has said, if you want reality, watch a documentary.
A film based on a graphic novel, based on an older film, based on ancient Greek propaganda, based on a true story, 300.
All the titles so far mentioned deliver to the film audience a movie in which you sit back and watch it. They all still feel like films. How do you get an audience to engage in the process of watching like they do when they read a comic book? How to make it feel like they are part of the process, flipping the pages when they're ready to move on, instead of mindlessly taking in the media? The world of the story needs to be a form of transmediality, meaning the story and world are not inherently bounded to a particular form. It has the ability to translate and transform before us into unexpected new forms. The 2010 Edgar Wright-directed film Scott Pilgrim vs. the World is a comic book movie adapted from the series created by Brian Lee O'Malley. According to Lita Wu, this story and world is a transmedia one. The original story by O'Malley merged different pictorial forms, distinguishing itself between the material and the virtual. It contains manga and video game motifs, as well as sound and music, which are presented as visual onomatopoeia. Like most of the other comic book movie adaptations mentioned before, this one also condenses the source material. Six books by O'Malley are streamlined into one movie. Many flashbacks, secondary characters, and sub and side plots are removed by Edgar Wright. As Thoss puts it, this reduces the film to a series of fights which intensify the video game quality of the narrative. Neither the beat-em-up nor the fighting game is a story-driven genre. At best, the battles might be bookended by cutscenes containing bits of dialogue or narration, with whatever minimal plot is there serving as but a frame for the game's actual raison d'être. I don't know how to pronounce that. The film tightens up the story and becomes more similar to this type of game, thus outdoing the comic book. But I think Thoss forgets that there's also a Scott Pilgrim vs. the World video game, which literally is just fight scenes, epic battles, and such. Introducing visual similarities to comic books and like the Batman TV series, which incorporated visual onomatopoeia, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World adds another layer, sound design. Comics and books have one common mountain to climb, translating the medium of sound in their work. Film, since the invention of synchronized sound, can materialize that aspect. The comic book for Scott Pilgrim is about a video game-like world. The film takes that a step forward and enhances this with sound effects from video games, and the result immerses the viewer into a film that transposes comic book, video game, and movie.
Not so long ago, in the mysterious land of Toronto, Canada, Scott Pilgrim was dating a high schooler.
Also, the visual onomatopoeias of Scott Pilgrim incorporate themselves into the world, unlike the Batman TV series, which feels separate. The words enter and leave differently depending on the length of the sound they are synced to and how the sound hits. As Wu put it, when drummer Kim mimes shooting herself in the head, BLAM! Appears in the air next to her. Recorded sound and image moving perfectly in sync. The letters fall out of frame, one by one, like a row of dominoes. Which is contrasted to how each time the doorbell rings, ding dong, appears on the screen, each syllable in complete synchronization with the ringing. The result is an illusionistic synthesis of image, text, and sound, in which words have their own materiality. Each font seems to have its own personality and substance. Afterwards, ding dong dissolves ephemerally. Wright's Scott Pilgrim also pushes these elements further and forces the audience to be active in the film. In one scene, Scott's practicing with his friends for an upcoming battle of the bands when he gets up to go pee. It is one long, tracking backward shot into the bathroom. A full pee bar, like a health bar in a video game, appears floating beside him. The bar not only floats behind Scott, but is also reflected in the bathroom mirror. As Scott pees, the bar drains with sound effects added, then it disappears when Scott flushes the toilet. All of this adds to the materialistic nature of this translation, but Wright takes it a step further. Scott turns around and opens the door and enters a high school hallway, complete with lockers. Again, not once breaking the long take, this creative use of editing seen throughout the film forces the audience to sit up and watch closely, to engage with the picture so not to miss anything. All of these elements push the idea of adaptations to a form of transmedia storytelling, and as Wu points to Henry Jenkins' concept of convergence, or the tendency for different media to merge through overlapping narrative and communicative connections, and today's convergence of stories makes transmedia storytelling all the more likely. Because of the multiplicity of references to different media within the Scott Pilgrim comics, expanding the narrative across different platforms has been organic. For example, Scott Pilgrim vs. the Animation, an animated short that was put on television that filled in some subplots from the original comic book, not featured in the actual live-action film. To close, adaptations in film are a hot-button issue. Some people feel that the original source material is the best version and that no cinematic adaptation will be good enough. Also, there is a snobbery amongst those who read books. It's as if reading is the ultimate form. Though I would remind them that books such as 50 Shades of Grey exist, as well as plenty of Fabio-featured steamy romance novels. They're basically the softcore porn of the literature community. So as some films merely choose adaptation and some do more by translating the original material, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World goes further. With all the editing techniques, visual gags, cinematography, and sound design, film doesn't feel like a film when watching it. It's something more. Edgar Wright's Scott Pilgrim in its 2D form reminds us movies can do more than entertain us. They can engage us. So I wonder then, should we be fighting for adaptations in today, or translations?